Divine Truth Assistance Group. These group assistance sessions are about putting principles of divine truth into action. This discussion is part of the 2014 Australia Group 1 series. Jesus gives personal truth to Alwyn Campbell and Neil Henderson, filmed on the 17th of July 2014 in Monkerai, New South Wales, Australia.
How's everyone going? Okay. How are you finding these little sessions?
Great.
Helpful? Okay. Well, Alwyn thought the issue was one. She raised a number of issues with me on the feedback sheet, and she thought it was one issue, and it's not that issue, she thought. So she's now going, and then she's going, hang on a sec. She was all prepped for that one, not prepped for this one. Yeah. Okay. Well, welcome, my dear sister. You've been demonstrating a lot of strong desire to get in to really see what's going on, haven't you? Mm-hmm. Yeah, and that's wonderful. So it's really good to see that. The issue I was going to talk to you about was the issue you raised, and that was the issue about your anger. When, in particular, when you know that, well, perhaps if you describe for us what the issue really is. You notice something is, when something is wrong, that your anger is wrong, like you know that that's wrong, and you know that you shouldn't necessarily have got the addiction met, but you're still getting angry. So that's the issue, isn't it? Probably. Perhaps you could give us an example where that's happened, if you could think of one on the spot, like I've just put you.
Yeah, yeah. Because it just happened just before we came.
No worries.
Okay.
Good.
We were going to out to do shopping.
Yep.
And my partner put the keys, car keys, on top of an Aldi catalogue, and he wanted, this is really basic.
So
right?
He put the car keys on top of an Aldi
catalogue because he wanted something out of the catalogue.
And an Aldi catalogue.
Aldi.
Sorry, shopping centre catalogue.
Gotcha. Shopping centre. And, you know, time was getting on and I rushed out the door. There was an inkling of a little bit of, you know, the catalogue, but I just put the catalogue somewhere else and grabbed the keys and we went. Yeah. And we get, you know, a kilometre and a half away and he asks me, did I bring the catalogue?
Yes.
And I say, no, I didn't. And then he kind of attacks me, right?
When you say he attacks you, what did he say?
He said, I can't remember all the details, but, you know, I put those keys on there because I wanted to take the catalogue, and that's sometimes what we do when we go out. We put things
on top
so we don't forget. But it was just a bloody little catalogue, right?
Yeah.
And he'd already looked at it.
Yeah, already.
Okay.
Yeah, coming up. That's really good.
Yeah,
go.
Yeah. And
and he'd already looked at it, so he should have already known what was in it.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So then I.
And now he's blaming you.
He's blaming me, yeah. And I said, well. It was your responsibility to get the catalogue, not mine.
Right.
Okay. And it's your responsibility. And he wouldn't hear that.
Yeah.
And I just got really furious. Yeah. And I should have just gotten out the car then, but, you know, I had a lot of stuff to do. And, you know, so I just fumed all the way there.
Yep. You know what you do? Is it silent treatment fuming, that one there?
Yeah. And part of it is I can't even say anything. I'm so furious. And, yeah. So get distracted at the shopping centre, come back home, and the next day I try to bring up in a rational way that I'm, you know, why I felt, you know, I felt really clear about the fact that it was actually his responsibility and that's why I got angry and everything.
Yeah.
And
did you get angry because it's his responsibility?
Well, no, I think I got angry because I wasn't seen to be right. You know, like he wasn't acknowledging that I was right and he was wrong.
He initially, let's say emotionally, from an emotional perspective, because I know Neil's pretty quiet, man.
Mm.
From an emotional perspective, he felt some blame towards you. Is that the case, Neil? Can we validate? Do you feel, from an emotional perspective, you felt like, oh, why didn't she do that for me? Yeah.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yep.
And perhaps we might have to invite Neil here to actually. They were also your keys and she grabbed them. But Do you want to do that? Yeah, why not? It's now turned into a couples counselling session. Okay, so the reason why I like to actually talk to a couple when there's an issue that involves a couple is because quite often I find one or both have a tendency to falsify what their feelings were at the time, right? And they also have a tendency to blow up the other person's feelings and dismiss their own and all sorts of things. So it's great if we can talk about these things together, and then we can go back to the anger issue that you've raised that you say you would like some help with. Now, remember, I've purposefully said that you say you want your help with. Okay, so let's. So the feeling in you when Alwyn didn't bring out the keys. Brought out the keys without the catalogue was. What was the feeling?
I was angry.
Just use the microphone.
Oh yeah, sorry. I was angry.
Well, angry is the response to the addiction not getting met. What was the feeling before the anger? See, this is what we've got to start learning to do if we're really going to ever resolve an issue. We've got to feel the feeling before the response. So anger is the response, but there was a feeling that you didn't want to feel that caused your anger. So what was the feeling you didn't want to feel?
Okay. I felt that I'd done...
If you just hold a bit closer now.
I felt that I'd done what I needed to do because I had things marked in the catalogue. Now,
yeah, that's okay, not a
no,
feeling.
No, no, no.
That's
I know.
Not a feeling
I'm just
yet.
Going to...
Yeah, keep going.
And I felt a childlike frustration. You know, I...
Yeah, that's the response to the addiction not getting met too.
Okay.
So let's keep trying to find... See, this is how difficult it is to find the actual emotion. Let's keep going. Let's find the emotion. See, when you do everything you think you've done to have something happen and then it doesn't happen and it didn't happen at the choice of somebody else. So in this case, Alwyn made a choice. She had to actually, she took the keys off the top and she made a choice, even though she saw the catalogue there, because otherwise if you didn't see it, you wouldn't have even been able to tell me about it, right? So you saw the catalogue there, but you chose to leave it there, right? So that was a choice. Now, what does that feel like on this end to you? When somebody makes a choice, you did something purposely and they made a choice.
She ignored my desire. She ignored my wishes. She ignored me. She doesn't love me. Sort of something.
Ah, now
something
we're getting
like
to
that.
The emotion.
Something
said.
Like
yeah.
that, yes.
There's the feeling in you that got triggered was that she doesn't love me.
Mm.
Right?
Yeah.
And it was just a little thing.
Yeah.
Tiny little thing, really, yeah. Right? But the feeling in you was she doesn't love me.
Mm.
So all of the anger that you came from your denial of the feeling that she doesn't love you.
Mm.
Does that make sense?
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
Now, you're not used to, great expressions of rage, right? You're used to subversive sulking and other
yep,
ways
yep,
of dealing
yep,
with
yep.
passive-aggressive
yep.
ways of dealing with
yep.
anger, right?
Yep.
So you sit there and you start projecting the rage, but you're not understanding in that moment that the cause of the rage is that you didn't feel loved. Right?
No.
You're not understanding
no,
that
no,
at all.
Because I was in this,
you're in your,
this
you're,
quiet fuming.
Well, yeah, you're already in the addiction not getting met.
Yeah.
And therefore, you're not actually seeing what the addiction was. The addiction is, I want my girl to do something for me and to even just guess to do something for me in this case, because it's not something you explained to her before you began. You wanted her to guess it. And by the way, we do this very frequently in relationships where we want the other party to guess what our problem is or guess the solution, because we actually see that as well as a loving thing to do if they guess, right? So even that is driven by this...
Like a telepathy.
Yes, we want them to be telepathic because that means they must love us, right?
Yeah. Yep.
If they were telepathic, it means they love us.
Yeah.
Good luck with that one. Right?
Yeah.
You say all the time, you don't want to be telepathic. You know, that's one of the things that we talk about.
But really the feeling is that we do. And if we're honest in our relationship, we want each other often to be telepathic with each other's problems, right? So we've got to see that. So we feel that, right? Now, so you're in that place where you're not feeling that emotion, that you weren't being loved here, that you weren't loved. Mm. And it's not really true even, because the reality is, as Alwyn correctly points out, you are responsible for the catalogue. Does that make sense?
Yeah.
And you are responsible to remember what's in the catalogue if you want to buy something, and you are responsible for going through the whole process. That is all true, but that's not the issue. The issue isn't one of responsibility. The issue is that you feel unloved. Right? And the issue's been complete. So now, Alwyn, when you try to explain to him that the issue is you were logical and it's his responsibility anyway, and how fair, unfair is it, you're skipping over one great big issue, and that is it's not about that for him. And you don't even understand what it's about at all. And I would ask myself why I don't. Because I know Neil well enough, I feel, to know that almost every time he gets upset, it's about a woman not loving him.
I know here that it's about him wanting the woman to meet his needs constantly. That sort of feels...
Yeah, you're not seeing it how I see it. No. See the anger in your, even the way you see it. The way you see it is he wants a woman to meet his needs all the time. That's not how I see it, see? How I see it is he wants a woman to demonstrate to him that she loves him. Now, that means to me he has sadness from his past about women not loving him. And I can have compassion for that. And you don't. Because all you feel is responsible when you think about that. Whereas I go, I can have some compassion for that. It feels terrible when in your past you've had things happen which demonstrate that the women don't love you. And you've got a lot of sadness to feel about that, which is churning up inside of you, you know. And it's definitely playing out in your relationship. So you're not actually assisting him to find the real reason here. Do you understand? Because you're angry, you can't see the real reason. In fact, the real reason he doesn't feel love. So if it was me, if I was his wife, right, which is pretty hard to do considering I'm a man, but if I was his wife and I saw that situation and I was actually in a state of love myself and I wanted to know the solution, I'd go, yeah, this is just all about Neil not feeling loved, you know. Hey, darling, I'd say to him, darling, you know, this is just all about you not feeling loved. And honestly, I'm sorry, but I didn't consider the thing when I saw it. And I was thinking about other things and so forth, and I was just walking out the door. But the reality is, you believing that this is an issue of love means that you've got some sadness from your childhood to feel about, and some forgiveness to feel, if you like, about women not loving you. Mm. And I'd even go further if it was me. I'd say, where in our relationship have you not felt loved? Can we talk about that? That's what I would do. Right? But for you, the issue is not about Neil not feeling loved. Right? Does that help so far? Because we've only talked a little tiny bit so far about this situation. So can you see the real issue now? The reason for your anger? Yeah. And can you see why you passive-aggressively display your anger?
Yeah.
It's manipulative.
Yeah.
You're not voicing your true feelings.
Yeah.
You're not saying, and you're also not connecting to your true feelings.
Yeah.
If you truly connected to your true feelings, instead of saying, I left the thing right there and, you know, why wouldn't you have picked it up? You noticed it there and, you know, it got into the physical side of it.
I'd probably cry.
Correct.
Perhaps, yeah. I mean, that's what I felt like, really.
If you use a mic.
Oh, sorry. That's what I felt like crying.
So you'd probably cry if you had let yourself feel.
Yeah. Yeah.
But why didn't you?
Facade. Habit. Or facade.
Yeah. Now you're just stabbing in the air.
Yeah.
Poking in the darkness.
That's right.
What's the feeling if you cry in front of a woman?
Oh, yes, yeah, weakness, weakness.
Yeah, see, this is the other feeling you're avoiding by not crying, right?
Yeah.
So you feel weakness. And feel...
And vulnerable and...
Yeah, and you don't want to feel any of that. And you don't want to... You know, obviously, things have happened in your childhood where you were made fun of for crying or you were made fun of when you felt sad and these are injuries that are inside of you now,
yeah.
Right? Okay.
Yeah.
So in the process, you've skipped over your real emotion. You're now arguing about the thing rather than actually discussing the emotion. And the emotion's got nothing to do with what he or you didn't do.
Mm.
What your wife did or what you didn't do. Mm. It's got nothing to do with that. It's got everything to do with the feeling you have of not being loved.
Yeah.
Right? And this feeling, honestly, in the situation, it was just a trigger, because the reality is there was no unloving behaviour in the action.
Mm.
Does that make sense?
Yeah.
Yep.
In the actual action.
In the actual action, yeah.
Yeah. Yeah.
When I reflected back, I thought there was, because there was just a little smidgen of, well, maybe I should take this catalogue. Then I thought, nah,
so
no, I
shifted.
So there's
a feeling you should.
Yeah.
Yeah. And to be honest with you, a lot of the times when we're really connected with our partner, we would know. So there's times when I know, yeah, Mary wants this and Mary wants that, so I just grab all of that. And Mary says, oh, I've got to go and get that. No, I've already got it. Don't worry about that sort of thing. These things happen naturally between us the more connected we become.
And maybe that little smidgen is actually passive aggression. I don't know.
Yeah, if you have that feeling that was there, if you're honest with yourself and you was a feeling there that catalogue and you saw Neil reading it and you thought that he might want it and there was a feeling of, no, stuff it, I'm going to take the keys anyway, if that was the feeling, and you've got to be honest with yourself about that, then that's obviously anger that drove that behaviour. Right, so the anger even began right back there. Yeah, okay. So are we okay with your side of it so far, Neil? Is that okay?
Yep.
You can understand what you've done there?
Yeah.
And you can understand how you were avoiding quite a lot of different emotions there.
Yes.
You were avoiding the actual initial feeling.
Yes.
Which was that unloved feeling. And even that initial feeling that I'm unloved is an addiction, because it's not even real. You weren't being, it wasn't a lack of love, right?
Mm.
But you were. There was a feeling in you about it, so that means there's something from your past that was being dragged into this.
Yeah.
Right, where somebody hadn't done things for you. And then, of course, you couldn't feel that. You decided to not feel that and instead project passive-aggressive anger. And that is all about your childhood as well. What did you do whenever something didn't get met? You couldn't go overtly rageful because you already got heavily punished, right?
Yeah.
So you learnt to come out with these underhanded ways of being angry that just sits there and stews on things and sulks about things and so forth.
Yeah.
Does that make sense?
Yeah.
And all that does is inflame Alwyn even further most of the time. Right. Do you understand why?
Not sure I do.
Because it makes her have to guess everything that's going on for you. And that's actually an act. That's you wanting her to love you by guessing now what the problem is.
Yes.
Does that make sense?
Yeah.
Rather than you saying what the problem is.
Yeah.
We do this in relationships all the time.
Yeah.
We want the other person to guess. We want the other person to guess what the raw problem was right from the start. And then we want them to guess what the solution is. And then we want them to guess how to help us with the solution. Mm. And when they don't do all these guessing right, they have to do it right.
Right.
We go, what's wrong with you? You don't love me anymore. Or, you don't love me in this situation. So these are all passive-aggressive ways of handling a relationship which don't work in a relationship.
Yeah.
So there's, in this one little tiny example, there's quite a lot there for you to have a look at from your perspective. Now let's go across to Alwyn, shall we, about what's going on. The question you asked at the beginning was, why... I know that I was just getting angry. I know I was getting angry. I know that there must be an addiction underneath this. Otherwise, I wouldn't be getting this angry. But you also know that you're getting real angry.
I was literally, because what happened was I brought it up the next day.
Yeah.
And that, I said that I felt angry because I did feel it was his responsibility and, he wasn't admitting that and stuff like that.
Yep.
And again... Neil started to blame me. Again, we went through the whole thing.
Yeah.
And flip, I was so enraged. I was just saying to Joy, I was jumping up and down so hard, I thought I'd go through the floorboards. I was so enraged.
And he's going,
yeah.
Oh, what's happening?
Yeah, exactly. He's like, what the hell,
It's only keys, it's only a catalogue.
Yeah.
But it's not just only a catalogue, is it? there's a whole heap of principles that have been present inside of both of you for a long time. And this is from childhood. Mm. These are issues that have been present from childhood. So, of course, when a little situation comes up, there's going to be an inflammation of those childhood issues. Mm. So the question then becomes for you, Alwyn, why is it that the rage persists even when you know the rage is so...
damaging.
Damaging.
Yeah.
So that's the real question, isn't it? So,
yeah.
So can we... What do you think the reason for that is?
Well, I think
yes, he has blamed you.
Yeah.
Yes, there has been an emotional feeling coming from him that, you know, you didn't love him in that moment. And there was, even if you allow yourself to think about it when you look back on it, there was a touch of a feeling when you picked up the keys, maybe I should grab the catalogue.
Yeah.
So even that, there was a bit of anger in that, wasn't there? That, oh, I'm not going to pick up the catalogue and we'll see what happens with this.
Yeah.
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 So the question then comes, okay, why is the rageful response so strong? What did you feel? So even when you could have picked up the catalogue, what was the feeling? Let's start there.
It was, like I said, it's probably a little bit of like passive aggressive anger.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And what was the purpose of it though? Does he often expect you to do things for him around the house?
Yeah.
Mm. You feel?
Yeah.
Right.
I feel that, yeah.
You feel that?
I do feel that, yeah.
Right. And I'm not saying it's necessarily true here.
Yeah.
Because quite often what we think or feel is very much based upon not acknowledging what the other person actually does. You know, so we've got to be careful with all this.
Yeah.
But this is the feeling you had, yes?
Yep, definitely.
You have that.
And by the way, I've still got that feeling that I do a lot more than he does. It's still there, right?
Yes.
And me, I'm admitting
fine.
That.
That's fine. Yep. No worries.
Yep.
So even that feeling alone is going to leave some anger. There's some anger festering there, isn't there? That feeling. If you looked at the situation honestly, Neil, around the house in terms of looking after your personal needs and taking responsibility for your personal things, do you feel that there is a bit of a imbalance there, or do you feel
for my personal needs, I take care. Oh, sorry. For my personal needs, I take care of that.
You do your own washing?
Yes.
You
yes.
do your
for
own
both
ironing?
Both of us. And I do my own ironing, including hers sometimes.
So,
a good ironer.
Okay.
Very good.
So he's pretty good with that. And cooking?
Cooking, we share.
We share. So, sounds pretty even. So, in terms of cleaning up around the house, tidying up after yourselves?
Tidying up, but
Alan's there shaking her head this way. Why?
Well, I have
okay.
my. Okay, sorry, yeah. sorry.
Okay.
Yeah. Why do you go like this?
Well, because I have a feeling, and this is an angry feeling, that I actually am the one that takes responsibility for keeping the house clean and tidy. You know, doing the, you know. All the details. You know, I do the pantry. You know, Neil doesn't do any of
the
stuff.
Washing.
We share the washing. We share washing and cooking
and you share the ironing.
Mostly, although sometimes he will do a little bit of ironing for me, but on a rare occasion, he's really good like that. Yeah. Well, it's feeding an addiction.
So he does some things more. You're admitting that.
Yeah.
Okay.
And then I also take...
But when you have to do things more, it's not fair.
Well, I do lots of things more. And in terms of time, I feel like I do all the garden. I take responsibility for the garden right around the house, by and large, like sometimes he does. But, you know, I have a real feeling that I am... And I know this is my mother's feeling, actually, that, you know, I take the burden of the time that it takes to do stuff around the house.
Right. So whether this is true or not, that's the feeling.
Yeah, I do have it.
Right?
Yeah.
Yep. And Neil, you obviously don't feel that's true.
No. Well, I do all the maintenance, you know, the physical maintenance.
Yeah, if you hold it close.
I do all the maintenance around the house and in our section. I do hoovering, but I probably need prompting, but I do the hoovering as well. We share that.
Yeah.
I take care of the car and... tradies and all sorts.
So there's all things you do that
I do other stuff.
So does Alwyn take care of the car?
Pardon?
Do you wash the car?
She does Hoover it. Well, we share.
I do. Yeah, we share the washing.
So you share a lot at the maintenance.
Yeah. And occasionally, I'll say, look, I think we need to check the oil, but usually Neil checks it when I say we.
Yeah.
So can I say that Neil obviously feels there is a fairly even balance of what's going on, but you don't. Okay. So now there either is or there isn't, is the truth, isn't it?
Well, we started to deal with this issue because it was becoming such an issue, and we decided to get together and write down what needed to be done daily, you know, two daily, weekly and monthly. Yeah. We just started that list.
And then what did you do? Did you divvy it up to each other?
We hadn't yet. We hadn't. We just started writing it down.
Before coming here.
Actually. Yeah.
So that was your intention, to divvy it all up and work it all out evenly in terms of time.
Yeah.
Yeah. It sounds to me like you're penny pinching, both of you.
We were?
Sorry. You're penny pinching, both of you.
Oh, yeah. Okay.
Emotionally, penny pinching. Do you know what I mean by that?
Yeah.
And see, for me, if I really love, right, and I have a viewpoint that the other part of me, so you obviously have a viewpoint that this is the other part of you, otherwise you wouldn't be there, right? If this is the other part of me, then whatever we choose to do, we're doing for each other and together, for our collective soul, our one soul, is the way I see it with Mary. So it's not a competition of who gets to how much, and it's not none of that to me. Each person would do as much as they're able. Does that make sense? And when I say as much as I'm able, that means that I would do everything I possibly could in the day to make sure that everything runs smooth in that day. And that includes even loving myself and loving the other person and giving each other time to have a break from doing things, right? Okay, and that also means that I wouldn't be driven by addictions to please the environment. In other words, I wouldn't be worried about whether my next door neighbours think my lawn's mowed when I know both of us are tired and we both don't feel like doing it.
Yeah, I have a real problem with fear of someone coming up and finding the house in a wreck.
That's why I raised that issue. Right, so in other words, you're worried about how people think of
you, it's approval.
What they'll think of you, what approval. And this causes us at times to become a bit of a slave driver where we want to get all that done, not for the right reasons. It's not for the betterment of our soul, but it's so that we could have the facade that somebody else, you know, sees our nice pretty place or sees the fact that we've vacuumed the floor. Recently, myself and Mary, we had a very busy time preparing for these groups, right? And if you came into the house, you would have noticed almost floor to ceiling stacked with all sorts of things I was working on at the same time. And Mary sometimes wanted to go and vacuum the floor. And I said, don't bother about it, darling. I'm just making more of a mess. And I need to make this mess in order to get all these things done. Don't worry about it to the end. And she said, well, when people come around, it's a bit messy. And I said, well, so be it. You know, we're getting a lot of work done. It's a bit messy. So what? Like, forget about that. Forget about the way it looks to everyone else. What's best for your soul? And so at night, like I've been working 8 to 12 hours every day getting things ready for the group. And so at night, I don't want to then have to go and clean the house because the next day I'm going to just dirty it all up again anyway. So I didn't bother, right? And I'm saying to Mary, are you okay with this? Because if you're okay with this, I'm okay with this, right? And if Mary wasn't okay with it, I'd be going, okay, why aren't you okay? Because I need a rest. I've been working all the time. Can you either help me do all of this technical stuff, or if you can't, which most people can't, then let me do it, but don't expect me to do the rest. Now, for myself and Mary, we both had a huge amount of things to do. We didn't bother tidying up our room, our house and making it all comfortable. I think Barb came around during that time to drop off a disc and it was all a mess. Corny came in and he took one look at the floor and says, I need the vacuum cleaner, right? Yeah, because we'd just before we come in, I'd moved the whole table and all of our chairs and everything were stacked with electronic gear and I just get it all up and I pushed it into the room so we could sit down and talk. And he walked in the door and I was still doing that, you know. And he starts, said, where's the vacuum cleaner? I give him the vacuum cleaner. If you want to clean it, that's fine. It's no stress off my nose. I'm okay to leave it like it is while we talk, right? And I don't care about his opinion about that. Does that make sense? Mm. And if he wants to clean it up, he wants to help, that's fantastic. I'm helping him with the talks and everything, so if he wants to help, that's great. But if he didn't want to, I'm perfectly happy to leave it all a mess. So the question then becomes, how much is of my desire to get things done is actually driven by a pure motivation to benefit our soul, and how much of it is actually driven by public opinion?
Pretty much all of it's driven by public opinion.
Okay, so this is a problem. This is an addiction. Now, when the addiction does not get fulfilled, in other words, one or both of you don't do all the things assigned in the day, what happens? Somebody gets angry. Well,
I get angry, but I also do self-abusive things like do it.
Of course, that's also self-abusive, I agree. But because you feel overloaded now and you're not having any rest, you now want him to have no rest as well. Is that not true?
Yeah.
Yeah.
And just sometimes when we're out all day, I could just do with a little snack at the end of the day.
Yeah.
And not tidy up and all that sort of stuff.
Yeah.
And because we're both stuffed.
Yeah.
But you know, there's this feeling that we have to have a whole full-scale meal and tidy up and all that sort of stuff.
And you do have to ask, so how much of that is gone for what you want or what you're imposing on Neil, or does he really want that? Or, you know, what is the real reasons for all of these kind of behaviours? So what I'm suggesting to you, rather than analysing everything in detail, what I'm suggesting is a lot of our actions in a family-based arrangement, in a couple-based arrangement, are driven by the addiction to please other people other than our soul. And then we impose upon each other that addiction, because the addiction makes, when it's not met, gets angry, and then we impose it upon each other. So that's one part of this issue for you, Alwyn. I know how worried you are about other people's perception of you and how concerned you are.
It's almost like life-threatening, you know, because of my little baby child. Yeah.
It's a huge addiction for you in that the compulsion is so great. And this compulsion causes you to not love you, but it also causes you to not love him.
Yeah.
Now, what's his injury?
He wants to be loved
by a woman. Now, of course, he's going to, every time this happens, he's going to feel, oh, I'm not being loved again. And the reality is, in this case, he's right. Right, so there are times when he's wrong, because it's a historical based thing based on childhood feelings, and then there's times where he isn't being loved and he's right, right? And he's going to attract both situations, right? And you are going to need to feel them, Neil. You're going to feel this unloved behaviour.
I know.
From your perspective, though, Alwyn, can you see that some of this anger that's coming up for you is actually the result of another addiction that has nothing to do with your relationship? It's got everything to do with perception, with how other people perceive you, right? And what you described to me is a fairly balanced relationship when it comes to actually getting things done. Right, you each seem to have, sometimes you do some more things in the house, but sometimes he does some more things outside of it, and particularly with the car and other things like that. And that's a pretty balanced relationship when it comes to doing things, right? But it's not pleasing you for a reason. And if you look at the primary reason, it's not because of love, of you guys loving yourselves and choosing to do something. It's because you feel driven to do them. And whenever we feel driven, that's one of the compulsion feelings, tells me that it's an addiction.
I feel it. I feel it. I kind of recognise it's driven, but that's as far as I go.
So the real question then becomes, and we get back to your original question now, why the anger, even though you know that all this is going on? So what do you think the reason is for the anger? So when you get angry about things not being done around the house, and then you feel like you have to do them, even when both of you are tired and you don't even really feel like doing them yourself, and you want Neil to help you do them, and then when he doesn't, you get angry about that, or when he's resistive, you know, when he says he doesn't come up and do it himself, you know, he has to be prodded to do it, you get resistive or angry. Why do you get angry? Can you feel the feeling? What's the feeling? Remember, I with Neil, what I had to do is put him back. Now, what was the feeling, mate, that you were feeling? And what I'm trying to do here is with you is, what's the feeling that you have? What's the feeling that causes the compulsion, that causes you to overwork yourself and then demand that somebody else overworks themselves?
And it might not be right, but the feeling that I don't know, incapable of love, and I do things for people to get love. You know, I have that feeling inside of me anyway. Yeah. I don't know if it's related to this.
Well, let's just look at the situation a bit more closely. And sorry to labour this point with you a bit. I'm trying to help you reason. What we're trying to do in these sessions is help you reason yourself rather than be reliant on another person. So this is the kind of thing you're going to have to do for yourselves if you're really going to find the addictions involved. So what is your primary motivation for making sure you have a lovely garden? If you use the mic.
People will think I'm skillful, or that they'll approve of me because I've created something beautiful.
Right, okay. So you feel that you have to create a thing that's outside of yourself to be beautiful, and then they'll approve of you. So you feel that's one of the reasons? Yeah? Any others that you can think of that come to your mind? So this is now what we're doing now is we're intellectually analysing. Remember the deconstruction of the facade talk. We're intellectually analysing the reason for the addictive behaviour in the first place. That's what we're trying to do here. Does that make sense? Because that will help us, that will tell us why I'm getting angry. That'll tell me, that'll intellectually tell me why I'm getting angry. So one of the reasons, what we basically said is one of the reasons why you're getting angry at this stage is that if your house is untidy or the yard's untidy, there's a feeling that other people won't like you very much or they'll disapprove of you somehow, and you feel that very personally. You feel like that's a personal attack upon yourself somehow.
Because I know I have such a lot of terror in me, and I know that I was not welcome as a baby and attacked by not just my parents but a couple of other people around.
Yeah.
And when I've just gone into just a tiny little bit of terror about it, I feel like I'm going to... I don't think it's intellectual, but I feel like I'm being smothered. Really smothered, and maybe gonna die, something.
So there's a so if somebody doesn't approve of you, you almost feel like you're gonna die.
Yeah.
With it, so it's that big inside of you.
Yeah.
Yeah. Is that true? From God's perspective, if I don't approve of you, are you gonna die?
No, because I've done terrible things to you and haven't died. Right?
Yeah. I haven't died, and you haven't died. So it's obviously not an adult feeling, is it? It's obviously something coming from a very, very hurt emotion inside of yourself. You can recognise. Now, can you see that because you don't want to be overwhelmed with that emotion, a lot of anger comes out of you, trying to prevent the overwhelm. Can you see that? So the extent of the fear you have is also the extent of the rage you experience. Can you see that? And whenever there is any implication that you have not been loving, the rage just goes through the roof, isn't it? Because you're so afraid, and you're afraid to feel something. So what is it that you're afraid to feel? So can I put you back?
Yeah.
You're there, you see the catalogue on the table because that's the original event. See the catalogue on the table, your keys are on top, and there's a feeling in you, maybe I should pick up that catalogue because I saw Neil with that. No, I won't do that. There's a feeling in you that he left that catalogue there just to annoy you.
Yeah, because he leaves things on every papers on every flat surface.
Yeah, and there's a feeling that he'd done that just to annoy you. And what annoys you about that? And I'm not saying it isn't annoying. I'm just saying what annoys you about it.
He doesn't take my feelings into consideration about it. He just.
Oh, be very careful with that. What is annoying? See, from God's perspective, does God create messes?
No, we're
God
good
cleans
at that.
Up messes, right? Yeah. Okay, so God cleans up messes. So Neil, when he creates a mess and doesn't clean it up, he's out of harmony with God straight away, right? I agree. But that's not your problem. Your problem is he leaves the mess or the thing on the table. It's not really a mess, it's just a thing on the table, right? Yeah. And what is he, what's the feeling?
That he wants the woman to run round after him.
And that's your feeling, yeah, I agree.
Yeah.
You do feel that.
And
what are you already doing? You're already running around everybody else, running around for everybody else.
Yeah.
Because you're running around trying to get the approval of everybody else by having a nice house, nice tidy yard, nice this, nice that, nice this, nice that.
Yep.
And he's just created an untidy part of it.
Yeah.
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 Hasn't he?
Mm.
Right? That's your feeling. And your feeling is, I've had enough of this. Isn't it?
Yeah, I guess
it
is.
Why have you had enough of it? It's not because it's not conducive to what you both want to achieve together. It's because you're worried about what everybody else thinks. That's why you've had enough of it. If you gave up with the feeling of what everybody else thought about it, you would be more focused on what is best for you too, wouldn't you? Rather than what is best for you two to display to everybody else.
Yeah, and Laura got a little twinkling of that when she said she focuses on people who don't like her instead of focusing on people who, you know.
Who love you.
Yeah.
Yeah. And the feeling I get from Neil quite a lot strongly is that he has a deep care and love for you. And I think you can feel that at times.
Yes.
Yep.
Yeah.
But these aspects annoy you. And the bits that annoy you, if you're honest with yourself, you'll see that a lot of it is not just. See, if it was just the issue of him being untidy, then I'd say, look, darling, this is an issue of love of self and also it's an issue with God, like not wanting to keep things tidy is an issue between yourself and God as well, like because God keeps things tidy, so you're out of harmony there. But you wouldn't feel this rage about it. You'd feel actually a bit sad about it, that Neil doesn't have the love of self to actually want to tidy up after himself, and you'd focus him on his lack of love of self for not tidying up after himself. Does that make sense? But you're not focused on that. You're focused on what? You're focused on he's now made extra work for me because while this mess is around, somebody walks in the house, it's going to be all untidy. How do I get my approval? It's all by making it all tidy, neat. No, it's basically making everything perfect around you so nobody has anything to complain about with you. That's really what you're terrified of, isn't it? As soon as there's a complaint, that means they don't like you. It's not perfect anymore. You're not perfect anymore. As soon as there's a complaint. Right? And this is a part of the rejection feeling, as you correctly pointed out, from your childhood. And that's the feeling you're avoiding.
I know from my mother's telling me that every night, every morning, the landlady or the landlord would come and complain that I've been crying and waking them up. You know, and that'd be, I'd feel attacked from everyone. My parents would want to shut me up and they'd want to shut me up.
Yep, and it was just because you felt sad, right? Because nobody loved you, that was the feeling.
So that other issue, I finally touched on a little bit last night when you talked about how much love is given to little children in the spirit world. It just finally I was able to, because I can't cry very much at all, and finally I just got a little bit of crying, just a little squeezed out.
So can I suggest one thing to you, Alwyn? The reason for the extent of your rage is because you are terrified of how much grief you have. And so this is why there's a tendency to overreact to little events. Does that make sense? When you overreact to a little event, you instantly get angry. And then, of course, that exacerbates Neil's issue from his childhood, which is this feeling that he's not getting love from a woman, right? That's his issue that he's yet to actually fully grieve. And so then he gets passive-aggressive. Does that make sense? The more passive-aggressive he gets, the more angry you get. Because there's now less love coming towards you, and then it just becomes a cycle that goes way out of control. And by this stage, you're jumping up and down, getting quite influenced at that point, feeling a whole heap of things that actually have nothing to do with the original situation, but rather have everything to do with the history of your childhood. Does that make sense? Yeah. Things that you don't want to feel. So let's go back to the anger. The anger is a choice to not experience the fear associated with the hurt child.
I recognised that the other day, that I choose that, and in choosing that, I'm severely damaging myself, but also my partner. I sort of kind of got that.
Yeah.
Yeah.
But let's rewind now. Let's go over just what I said. The anger is a choice to avoid the feeling of the fear of the hurt child's emotions.
So all my fear, a lot of my fear is about that?
A lot of your fear is about that. I'm not saying all of it is, but a lot of it is. But the point you're not getting to, and so I have to say it again. The anger is the choice to avoid the feeling of the fear about the hurt child.
So
there's an internal choice you're making.
Okay.
To not feel your fear.
Yeah.
And when you make that choice, you will get angry.
Yeah.
That's your choice. You're making the choice to get angry.
Mm.
You're not seeing it as a choice. Even now in this discussion, right now, you're not seeing it as a choice you're making.
Mm.
It's almost like you feel it's a given. It's automatic. It's like, why wouldn't I get angry? You're not seeing it as a choice. And remember on Saturday, Mary talked about strengthening the will to love, right? You're making a choice in that moment to be unloving to yourself. It's immaterial. You're also making a choice to be angry with your partner. That's a side issue. You're making a choice to be unloving to yourself, and you're not seeing the unloving choice. The unloving choice is to deny your fear. That's an unloving choice. And you make that unloving choice. And then you expect Neil to go along with that unloving choice. Now, if he's a wise man, he would never do that. Now, sometimes he does do it and sometimes he doesn't. That's the reality. Sometimes he panders to your fear and other times he doesn't pander to your fear. And just depends on whether whether an argument happens. When he panders to your fear, no argument happens because you've now got your choice fulfilled. Your choice to be unloving has been fed by the addiction that you don't get to your fear, and that choice being fulfilled means you're now happy again, or content, shall we say. You're not really happy, right? And then he gets happy because he's done something good for his wife, and then he feels like he's loved, right? So there's his addiction in the process. But when you make the other choice, the choice to get into a rage or into anger, you're not seeing it as a choice.
So it's a compulsion.
No, you see it as a right.
Yes. Yeah.
Can you see the difference?
You're
not seeing that it's an unloving choice. You see your anger as a right. You believe you're right.
When I decided on the addiction that I was going to do, it was about being right, but that's a different kind of right, isn't it?
Yeah. No,
yeah.
In this case, you think that anger is right. You think that being angry is the right choice. The person deserves it, is your feeling.
Yes.
And really what you're saying is that a person deserves it because they didn't make your fear go away.
Mm.
And anybody who doesn't make your fear go away you believe deserves your rage. Does that make sense? Mm-hmm. And this is the main problem with the use of your will that you need to examine. Why do you believe that a person who doesn't make your fear go away deserves your rage? That's the question you need to personally resolve, because they don't deserve your rage. In fact, if anything, they deserve your praise. They deserve your, it's a helpful thing for them to not make your fear go away. But that's not how you feel. When your fear becomes present, you believe that anger is the right response. And it's that choice towards anger in that moment that is causing you to get angry in these situations.
So I should be going off and feeling the fear?
No, because you don't want to do that. What you need to do is you need to look at what you believe is the rightness of your choice. You need to, do you see what I'm saying? You're trying to go down one step below where you need to be. Where you need to be, see, one step below is choosing to feel your fear. But you don't want to do that.
Sometimes I think I do, and I go through a whole process and I do feel a little bit.
But as soon as there's a trigger in a day-to-day
life. It's only on an individual basis by myself.
Correct. Yeah. Under controlled circumstances, yeah. That's when you do it.
Yeah.
And is that really dealing with fear?
No.
Because it's a controlled circumstance that you've manufactured.
Addiction to control.
Correct. Yeah. So in reality, when there's an uncontrolled circumstance that occurs, what happens every time? Every time there's an uncontrolled circumstance that triggers your fear, what happens? You choose anger. That's what happens. So you need to be honest about that. I'm choosing anger. That means I'm using my will to choose anger. I'm using my will to choose it. Now, what needs to change is I need to use my will to choose to not be angry and feel my fear instead. That's what I need to do. So where you need to start is looking at why you're choosing your will with your will to get angry. What does the anger give you that the fear doesn't give you? The anger gives you something that you're addicted to.
Well, it's control. Isn't it control of my fear? I don't know.
Well, let's be more specific.
What makes me feel powerful?
It gives you a feeling of having power over the problem of fear. It gives you power. So you're addicted to the powerful feeling that anger gives you. Do you understand?
Yeah, and by and large, it's kind of subversive anger. It's not rage like I got into, you don't see the rage. I just feel...
When I first met you, it was all very passive-aggressive, like your husband's anger has a tendency to be, right?
Yeah.
But now it's coming out a bit more, shall we
it
say.
It is, and it's been a very recent occurrence.
Okay, so this is an improvement of a kind
in
that you're no longer in passive-aggressive rage where you deny the whole experience, but unfortunately it's still the choice to use your will to get angry that is the problem. And the only way that's going to change is for you to take a different road. So you need to feel the emotion that causes you to make this choice. Does that make sense? So what's the emotion that causes you to make the choice towards anger rather than make the choice towards fear? That's the real question. Now, I could answer that question for you, but that wouldn't be helping you go through the process of what it is. So I'm going to put that question to you and leave you with that question. What is the feeling that you're going to have to feel? Because everything's about feelings. What is the feeling you're going to have to feel that causes you to want to choose anger instead of choosing fear when you have that choice? There's a feeling that causes you to go towards anger than going towards fear, and you want to be able to feel it. Now, can I give you some examples of what these kind of feelings are? And I'm not saying you have any of these, right? Because I need you to think about it for yourself. But one feeling is a feeling of hopelessness, that the fear is hopeless to get into. It's impossible to get into. It's never going to be resolved. So what's the point of even going there? So that's a feeling, right? There's a feeling that you can't trust that you're ever going to get to the bottom of the... Or if you let yourself go into fear, that you're never going to get out of it. There's a feeling that you might die if you go into your fear. Like, that's how strong we often feel things. That you'll suffocate, die from feeling your fear. Right? These are just some of the potential feelings that you're going to need to feel in order to stop this choice going to reverting to anger each time. There could be a feeling that you don't trust God at all, and therefore you don't trust God's way at all is the real way. Right? There's no faith in God's way.
I recognised last night, the night before, that I'm actually frightened of God.
So you feel like God's a punishing God. He's going to, you know, what's the point of ever entering a relationship with a punishing God? No point at all. So there's no driving force to pull you into the fear. And then there's this issue of power. So the issue of power alone could be enough motivation so that you can feel powerful over your fear rather than feeling weak in it. Does that make sense? That could be enough motivation to cause you to make that choice to rage every time. Do you see what I'm saying? So the issue you face now is you need to answer this question. It's more important for you to answer this question than almost any other question, in fact.
Even that other question that I asked, you know.
More important than any question is, why do you revert to rage rather than reverting to your fear? Because while you revert to rage every time, you're going to be damaging your soul further, you damage the souls of others further, you're not going to be able to have a relationship with God, you'll never get into any of your addictions, you'll never feel any of your hurt child. It's like you're going to be stagnant in this place until you make a different choice, and the key for you is to find the emotional reason why you make this choice. Do you see what I'm saying? So if I was you, what I would do is I'd focus all of my attention the next few weeks. Why do I make this choice? What inside of me causes me to make this choice to revert to rage every single time that my fear gets triggered? Why do I exercise my will, even though I know it's wrong? Why do I exercise my will in that direction every time? Do you see? Once you resolve that emotionally, once you let go of that emotion, you will now be open to make a different choice. But emotionally at the moment, you're not open to making a different choice. I know that if I trigger you enough of you, I'll get you into your rage. Do you know what I mean? And in particular, if I do it without you knowing. See, the problem with an event like this is that you come along, you go, I'm ready for AJ. I think I can hear what he's got to say, right? I'll be open and I'll be this and I'll be that. But that's not the kind of situation you face in your day-to-day life. In your day-to-day life, the kind of situation you face is like, bam, it just hits you and you didn't know it was going to happen. That's the kind of situation you face. And every time you face one of those situations, what happens? Bang, the rage. So there's a choice, bang, that happens right at that moment. The situation hits you, choice, fear triggered, bang, into my rage. And you need to know why. And so I would suggest to you, that's where you need to spend a lot of your energy, finding out why. Pray to God about why. Ask your guides why. You know, talk to other people about why they do it. Because some of their ideas might be what triggers some of yours. Does that make sense? Read books about anger and why. And, you know, do all the things necessary to seek the answer. Why do I make this choice? Use your will to find out why. And then when you find out why, use your will to feel that emotion. Because while that emotion remains in you, no other choice will be possible. Because your soul is already making that choice. And you'll have to use willpower to do anything else at the moment, which is what you're having to do, right? Yeah, and that's no good. That doesn't help you because you keep on failing. and that's an indication that it's just willpower. Once you know why and you feel the emotional reason why, you won't have to have willpower to make a different choice. Your will automatically cause you to make the choice towards your fear. Does that make sense? So once you find the emotion, your will automatically change once you release that emotion. That makes sense?
Yeah, and I've just only kind of recently realised that what I've been feeling in here, I've always thought of as fear, but it's a lot of it is rage.
A lot of it's rage, yeah. And you do have some childhood rage to feel, obviously, given the fact that nobody in your childhood demonstrated very much love to you, right? But you're not understanding at the moment. You do have a high demand for love, right? And demanded love, once it's received, is not actually love being received. It's not a gift of love, you know. So the reality is you don't even acknowledge at this point in time when you're being loved.
I find it really hard, you know, even when it's openly expressed.
Yeah, like I often see it in Neil's face and his demeanour towards you and everything, but you don't recognise it even at that moment.
Well, because I don't feel worthy of it. You know, I don't feel, why the hell would he feel like that even?
Well, yeah, you almost feel sometimes like he's a bit of a nut to do it, right? Yes. And then other times...
Why hasn't he buggered off long ago, you
exactly,
know?
Exactly, that's the feeling you have sometimes. And then other times you also have a feeling of like there's such a big hole in you for this love that no matter how much Neil feels this hole, while this hole remains, he won't have enough energy for the rest of his existence to fill it. Does that make sense? It's very important that you at some point get to that level. But that there's that childhood grief. And I'm suggesting forget about trying to feel all that at the moment, because the real issue is this choice you make towards rage. This is the thing that's stopping your further progress towards your fear, is your choice to rage rather than your choice to feel the fear. And I'm saying to you, the key area where you need to exercise your will now, right now, is to feel the reason why you choose rage. And there'll be a lot of potentially hopeless feelings in there, you know, of sadness and, you know, that it's pointless and all those kind of feelings, as I've suggested, but there may be other feelings that I haven't even mentioned. Does that make sense? But allow yourself to discover them. If you do not discover them and feel them, you will never get to your fear, nor will you ever let go of this great big hole about love that's inside of you. Yeah. That make sense? Good day. Thanks, guys.
Thank you very much.
Thank you. So what did you feel about that discussion? Yeah? You can see, can't you, that sometimes issues are very, very, seem very, very minor on the outside. But the reality is that they cover over very, very big emotions. And this is why Mary invented that phrase, always sweat the small stuff. You remember she said that? Yeah. And because of the small stuff often leads to, it covers over very, very big emotions. So thanks, guys, for being part of that discussion. Also, you notice that I focused on the issue of the choice that occurs. And remember, every choice that ever occurs inside of you is emotional. So the reason for every choice is emotional. It's not an intellectual decision. It's an emotional decision you're making. So when you choose rage over choosing to feel your fear, it is an emotional choice. There's an emotion driving it. The key is to find those emotions. And do you know what's best for most of you? Forget about finding anything else in that place. Just find that one thing. Have a single-minded purpose to find that one thing. That's the thing that's blocking everything else. Focus on that. Put all your attention on that. Don't get sidetracked from that onto other things. Focus on the thing that's causing the resistance. Focus on the thing that's causing the block. While that block remains, everything else is impossible anyway. Right? This is why in the spirit world you will only usually get help one thing at a time. Because what happens is the spirits who help you will just tell you the next thing.
And they know that until you deal with that next thing, no other thing that you need to deal with will be possible until you deal with that thing. Does that make sense? So allow yourself to see the next thing, not the thing that's 25 years' time or 5 years' time or 2 years' time or 1 year's time in terms of what you need to deal with. Allow yourself to see the next thing. And the next thing is always about your resistance to a lot of things. In Alan's case, her anger is the way she's always going to get away from everything if she's not careful, right? So that's the next thing she needs to address. Once she addresses that thing, then other things will come up. They will then be next. Remember, it's like layers. You got to deal with the outer layer before you can get to the inside one. And if the outer layer is I'm using my will to get angry every time I get into a situation where my addictions are triggered, then that's the thing I've got to focus on. And focusing on anything else is pointless, really, waste of time. Because it won't resolve that problem. Does everyone get that? G'day. And what is time? Quarter past two. Still plenty of time. So what we're going to do is just again have another little break for everyone to go to the toilet and everything. And Mary is then going to come up and discuss with you the homework that you did regarding your challenging your addictions. Does that sound good? Okay.